So now you'll see the legal protection to internally displaced persons in the international perspective. First, you'll see the international perspective means whatever legal protection has been given to IDPs by UN. And then we'll discuss its national perspective, that is what legal protections have been given in our country to the IDPs. First, we'll see the UN scenario. In 1990, the General Assembly handed over the function of coordination and assistance to IDPs to resistant coordinator, right? A designation, a position of resident coordinator was created by United Nations in the General Assembly held in 1990, and the function of coordination and giving assistance to IDPs was given to this designation, to this person, right? Then in 1991, a new post of Emergency Relief Coordinator, ERC, was created. And the purpose was to promote more rapid and consistent response to emergency situations which are faced by IDPs. Then in 1992, United Nations created the Interagency Standing Committee under the leadership of Emergency Relief Coordinator, ERC, which we discussed in previous point. Under his leadership, a committee was formed. And this committee was formed to strengthen and coordinate in emergency situations, right? This committee composed of heads of major United Nations humanitarian and development agencies. Whatever agencies of United Nations deal with humanitarian and developmental issues, the heads of all those agencies were the member of this committee. Then in 1997, Executive Committee on Humanitarian Affairs was framed by the Secretary General of UN. This committee was again chaired by ERC, that is Emergency Relief Coordinator, and composed of the heads of humanitarian development agencies and the UN Department on Peacekeeping and Political Affairs. The only difference from the previous one is the name was changed and one more member was added to it, which was the UN Department on Peacekeeping and Political Affairs. Later on, new department was framed. And it was named as Department of Humanitarian Affairs, DHA, was established to assist ERC, that is Emergency Relief Coordinator. After some time, DHA was replaced by a smaller office and it was renamed as Office for the Coordination of Humanitarian Affairs, OCHA. In 1992, the United Nations Commission on Human Rights requested the Secretary General to appoint a representative on the issues of human rights of IDPs for better understanding of problems faced by them. A dedicated representative should be there. This was the viewpoint of United Nations Commission of Human Rights. And for that purpose, they requested Secretary General of UN to appoint a new position of representatives in every country so that the matters of human rights of IDPs could be taken care of in a better way. The representative, with the support of Secretary General, this representative, which we have discussed in the previous point, established legal norms on internally displaced persons in 1994. Along with the support of Secretary General, this representative framed a legal norm, right? And those legal norms were for IDPs. These legal norms were framed to provide an effective system at national, regional, and as well as at the international level for the protection of IDPs so that a standardized procedure could be established all over the world. Later on, with a team of legal experts and scholars and in consultation with NGOs, non-governmental, regional, and international organizations, new international standards were framed in 1998. These legal norms, which we discussed in previous point, which were framed in 1994, they were revised after consulting with various parties, and these were revised in 1998, and these were known as guiding principles on internal displacement or even Deng's principle. So all this happened at international level in terms of legal protection to internally displaced persons. Now you'll see the legal protection to IDPs in India. Article 21 says it provides the framework for securing the right to life, and this right to life is for everybody, whether it is IDP or a normal citizen. Then Article 29, it guarantees the rights to preserve the cultural identity of any citizen or group of citizens from governmental encroachment. Encroachment means when the government forcefully interfere into the matters of some cultural group or cultural identity. So in that case, every group of citizen has a right to preserve or to save their cultural identity. Then Article 39 says it directs the state to secure its citizens with right to an adequate means of livelihood. Means everybody, whomsoever it is, every citizen has a right to have a adequate mean of livelihood so that they can earn money and they can spend money for the upliftment of their family. Then Article 41, it is the responsibility of state to secure the right to work, education and to public assistance in cases of unemployment, old age, sickness and in other cases of disability. This Article 39 and 41, both of them are in the directive principles which we have already discussed in Unit 1. Right. So it is these two points are only the guidelines to the government that they should follow these things and they should think about the betterment of the citizens. But all these articles are equally implementable on the IDPs. The Supreme Court expanded the meaning of right to life to include right to livelihood. Obviously, right to life is life with dignity, and for dignity we need money, and for money we need employment. So right to livelihood was later on included on the instructions of Supreme Court in the Article 21. Then the Supreme Court of India further elaborated on right to life to include right to adequate shelter. Then again, right to life include right to have a adequate shelter so that everybody can enjoy basic amenities in the life. The Supreme Court held that the right to life include right to food, water, decent environment, education, medical care and shelter, because all these basic requirements are necessary to lead a life with dignity. The court further held that right to life prohibited the eviction of slum dweller families unless alternative accommodation are provided. In the same manner, court prohibited government from eviction of slum dweller families from the slum areas unless and until the government provide them some alternative accommodation so that they can shift to that particular area. In another case, Supreme Court held that right to life, right to live, is not merely confined to physical existence, but include within its ambit the right to live with human dignity. That I have already discussed, and we also see this in Unit 1 when we discuss right to life in Article 21. As per Land Acquisition Act 1894, government can acquire land for public purposes. It says that state has no obligation to rehabilitate the displaced population. But along with that, there are certain contradictory laws also which make some escape for government. As in Land Acquisition Act in 1894, it has been written that for public purposes or for beneficial purposes, government may acquire land. And in this scenario, if certain population is displaced from that particular place, it is not the obligation or duty of the government to rehabilitate that. So these kind of provisions provide them certain escape, and because of these things, government always try to take leverage on such activities. Only the state of Maharashtra has a legislative enactment which recognize the rights of displaced people. In India, there is only one state whose legislative assembly has passed a law in which the rights of displaced people have been taken care of, and that state is Maharashtra. Other states have passed only resolutions and circulars regarding adequate resettlement and rehabilitation of displaced persons. Resolution and circulars are not legal foundation, but when it becomes law, it becomes a legal foundation. So in other states, there is no legal foundation for resettlement or rehabilitation of internally displaced persons. So in the next video, we'll discuss about the rights of refugees again in international and national perspective.